24 presentation. My name is David Swallow. This is the 12th presentation of the day, so we're just about halfway through. There's been a slight change to the schedule for our next session, and we're bringing forward our next slot by Nidhi, Arora, and the session by Shwetank Dixit will take place at 12 UTC, so the next slot. So Nidhi's session is entitled Democratising Knowledge. Nidhi is the co-founder of Top Gain, a consulting firm dedicated to IT strategy excellence in India's mid-sized businesses. Nidhi is going to be talking about how we make knowledge accessible to those who cannot use Google, Wikipedia, and those other great tools of democratized knowledge for us. So over to you, Nidhi.
Thank you, David, and good morning, good afternoon, everybody, in whichever part of the world you are. I am very happy to be here today. I also am the founder of an initiative called Isha, which works towards self-reliance for the visually challenged. And this session is a part of our Clabble project. So, in a world before Google and Wikipedia, if you wanted to find out about something, you went to a small or a big library like this one, and you looked at the index cards and tried to find something that worked for you. Then you opened the book, went to the index section if you were smart, and looked for the thing that you wanted to find out more about. That world after Google and Wikipedia became this. A search which would typically take us a few days went on to take us a few minutes. What that changed for us was that it, you know, in the world before Google and Wikipedia, the push factor of knowledge was about 80-90%. You went to school, you learned what you were taught, and if you were a very, very curious person, you went to the library and found something for yourself. Once we enabled this, the pull factor of knowledge and education became huge. Everybody around the world searched for 2, 3, 5, 10 items on a daily basis. That was a huge change in the push and pull denomination of knowledge and access to knowledge. But somewhere else in the universe, in a world before Google and Wikipedia, everybody went about their own thing, doing their own thing. And in a world after Google and Wikipedia, nothing changed. So what was this world? Who were the people who lived in this world? Okay. So the people who lived in this world were people who worked, people who did not go to school so much. In some parts of the world, the girl children, people who were too old to read, their eyes had failed them. And obviously people we work with, which is the visually challenged. So let's change that story. The background, and a lot of this is about India. Because I have done the bulk of my work in India. The first thing that happened here was that literacy is the only door to education, which means if you couldn't read, you couldn't access knowledge resources. The second, even within that, to be literate in your native language was not enough because there just wasn't enough knowledge, especially on the newer subjects available in your native language. So one, you had to be literate, and two, you had to be English literate. And three, not too many libraries nearby. And you will be surprised at how many people around the world still live in this world. And fourth, or just not available to us, it is a well-known fact that girl children are treated separately, differently from male children in some parts of the world, and my part of the world was among them. Likewise to some other groups where knowledge and knowledge resource access was just not there. So this was the problem statement that we were dealing with. We had a low effective literacy, even lower knowledge of functional English, and a hugely disproportionate spread of income and wealth. So what hampers economic advancement? First, most knowledge resources are in English. Second, they are in print. Third, Google and Wikipedia need both literacy and a working internet connection. So while it changed our life, it left a mass of population which could not be covered under the existing infrastructure. Within the visually challenged, we had falling braille literacy, and braille itself is bulky. So if I send somebody one book, I cannot send them the next book as easily, both in production and in distribution. And then if you're not affiliated to an institution, you get, you know, even lesser access to knowledge. What we wanted to do was to make audiobooks freely available, to use them to inculcate an early reading habit. Because when you come from a village and you want to go to a city or a mid-sized town, your peers are light years ahead in terms of general awareness. And that puts a huge burden on you emotionally to cope. Third, generate on-demand content. Next, to make study material, because a lot of children went into adulthood or a time when they had to choose their career without enough information and also without enough resources to help them pursue a career of their choice. And fifth, not letting blindness or lack of formal education or access to resources hinder learning and broadening the horizons of the mind. We were aware that there were people who wanted to learn for learning's sake, and we were not able to enable that for them right now. So the solution design, CLABIL stands for Central Library of Audiobooks in Indian Languages. We did this way back in 2010, so we now have 7 years of experience to discuss today. First is, it is central, which means it is online. It is accessible to everybody. The way it is currently designed is you don't need to sign up or subscribe or do credentials. And that comes from a person I was working with. He comes from a remote village in the northern part of India. And when we were discussing this, he said, but people in my village will never know what login and password means. So we completely in design eliminated the sign up requirements. Can be accessed using mobile phone and data connection, and very limited computer knowledge required the way it stands today. Library, because it keeps getting updated. We only have literary and academic content, and we are, there are no songs, no entertainment. It's an aggregator, which means we also link back to LibriVox, archive.org, and other sites which have free audio content. And then we created a cycle of demand. So we were able to give people what they wanted to read about or hear about. And then all content is downloadable, which means you don't need to, in a lot of blind schools, especially the internet time is rationed. So you could download, take the content back and just listen to it whenever you had time. And MP3 format ensures that people could use the cheapest player, audio player in the market. It was audio, which means it was quickly scalable, unlike Braille, which we worked with earlier. Does not assume literacy. My father was somebody who had to quit education in grade 8 because he had to financially support the family. And for the rest of his life, he is a history buff. And for the rest of his life, he kept asking people like us, tell us what is happening in the Indus Valley civilization. Tell me more about them. Medieval history, and he was also very interested in science, but he just could not access that content on his own. He depended on us. His English literacy was non-existent because he was in the India of the 50s and 60s, and therefore he depended on regional language newspapers for whatever information he could gather. And he was not alone. There's an entire generation of people which is growing up as we speak today, which faces the same challenge that my dad faced. Now, Braille, as some of you may know, has a separate notation in every language. So if you are a multilingual person, you don't need to learn the notation of every language that you want to access knowledge in. Personally, I use 4 languages, and that is true of a lot of Indians. At least 2 or 3 languages come naturally to most of us. and then it can be quickly refreshed. Volunteers only need to know the spoken language. The entire library, which today is at about 6,400 files in 20 Indian languages, has been done entirely by volunteers recording on their own personal time or by organizations getting their employees to volunteer. And the beauty of this model is that if you can speak the language, you can record. You don't need to know the script of that language. And we created a sourcing model where volunteers could record from anywhere, including their homes. And you know, if it was an organizational connect, then within their organizations at the event. And then it is in Indian languages, which is, mountain goes to Muhammad. Knowledge and life skills in the first language of the recipient. I cannot emphasize enough the importance of making it happen in their first language, because then it can reach rural areas, slum children, older people who may not be English fluent or even literate, or people from underprivileged backgrounds in any part of the country. And then, what we wanted to create essentially was a knowledge grid for all of our people. What else can we do with this? As the last point in the earlier slide said, the model itself, the problem statement of a large percentage of the population, which is very talented, but not equipped enough, is a challenge that's common to the BRICS countries, to most of Africa, a lot of South America. And if we just empower these people and enable them with knowledge resources which are available to them on demand, it can change their quality of life. To a girl child who's growing up somewhere, India very recently passed the Domestic Violence Act. A lot of the girls may not even be aware of the existence of the act, much less of how well it empowers them to deal with their daily challenges. When you keep them away from knowledge, you have a very direct impact on the quality of their life, even sometimes on the quality of their survival or on the survival. Likewise, if someone is a small trader, which my dad was, and you make it possible for them to understand business, understand finance, understand economics the way we did in B school and business school, you make it possible for them to create better business models for their own trade. You make it possible for them to understand, interpret, and benefit from the macroeconomic movements that are happening around them. When we don't do that, we are putting them at a disadvantage. And I don't think it's right to do that. So I think that this, the idea of a national knowledge grid, is very close to my heart. And I believe that such a thing will benefit not just India, but multiple countries, multiple communities across the world. Now, this is the 7-year experience. Execution must-dos. We learned that we have to be demand-driven. We created a lot of content which was subsequently not used as much as the demand-driven content was. We also learned that when we create such a knowledge resource, we need to go out into the market because people do not expect this to be available to them. We need to go out and tell them that this is there and it's available on demand and on the topics that they want. So we need to communicate and we educate. And third, we just need to keep at it every single day, every single morning, every single evening. And when you're feeling at your lowest, somebody will come by, contribute content of their own, or volunteer to record, or volunteer to help, and eventually it will work out. And on thank you. Can we change the world? I think we already did, one step at a time. I'm done and I'm ready for questions, if any.
Oh, okay. Let's just have a look over Twitter. Right, can we go in reverse chronological order? We got a question here from Priya asking, what is the vision for Esha Clubil in the next few years?
That's an excellent question, because somebody else asked me that last week for a press story, and it got me thinking. The vision is very clearly, we want to start the national knowledge grid with ourselves and with the partners. And we want to make it about, like I said, demand-driven, first language relevant knowledge content. We want to make it, enable it for all Indians, and then possibly take the model to other countries, economies that will benefit from a similar model.
Excellent, thank you very much. And let's see if there was anything else. No, I think that was it in terms of questions. Well, I'd like to, again, take the opportunity to say thank you very much for taking part. We're going to have a little bit of a break now, and we're going to resume ID 24 on the hour with Shwetan Dixit. So in the meantime, grab yourselves all a coffee, tea, whatever your beverage is, and we'll be back in about 40 minutes. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.